Okay, well, hello again. We'll continue with this again, with the third part of the course. As you see, I can talk and talk, and the time is running. Hopefully, this one will be shorter and finish at 2 o'clock. Okay? Well, the title of this one is The Design of Advanced Ceramics by New Processing and Sintering Routes. Well, I think I have here, yeah, the outline. Oh, again, please, if you lose that I'm telling you, stop me and I can explain, okay? First, as usual, a really short introduction, and then we'll go in detail for the processing methods, okay? A few ones that could be interested in order to reduce the amount of energy. And we'll talk about EPD, electrophoretic deposition. We'll talk also a bit about deep coating, doctor plate, and extrusion. And in the last part, I will talk about the sintering techniques, okay? Well, in the first presentation, we talk about the spark plasma sintering. Here, only a few slides about that, and more how it works instead of the classical presentation. Hot pressing. Well, I'm not sure if it's hot pressing, but and hot isostatic pressing, okay? Well, I don't want to focus here so much, but well, ceramics have been important from the really beginning. There are different ages, from the Stone Age to Bronze Age to Iron Age, but this one is totally impossible to pass from one to the other one without refractory material to contain them. I mean, it's impossible. Then even could be maybe better if we talk about Green Age and Fire Age, okay? Why ceramics were important during all these steps, of course, is the idea to perform bricks in order to create furnaces or the classical houses. That the people have done during several years is just a suspension of a clay. You have a really easy to create these bricks performed. You introduce here your suspension, that is water with the clay, that's only, you dry, and finally you obtain your pieces. Okay, this is the easiest one, the oldest one, and goes quite well. But of course, there are other methods. If you want to perform different materials, maybe you need to use other advanced processes. Nowadays, as I mentioned, there are many, but probably the most extended in ceramics is the slick casting. Okay? Here that you produce, first it's a suspension. Normally your ceramic powder, here in this case, for example, clay, that could be silicon carbide, silicon nitride, alumina, whatever you want. 50% argon, because of course you need at the end a slurry that are totally homogeneous. And here that we do is introduce this suspension in a mold, and the mold has the shape that you want, that you deserve, okay? And well, there are two possibilities. First is this one that when it's totally filled, you open the valve and then you drain everything, okay? And here in the wall of the material, in the mold, your material, well, it's not precipitate, but it starts to be deposited here, okay? And when you drain, you keep the form, okay? It's that it's called slick casting. There are other possibilities that is using this mold that is a porous one, okay? But in this case, it's just draining, then you can reuse again your suspension, and after that, you remove your mold, and you have your material in a green state. That, of course, you sinter, and you have it. This one is the most extended, that is really typical, that you see here the mold, you fill this in this gap, and you finally obtain your ceramic, and at the end, several of them, and sinter. I don't know if you have the opportunity to visit one. I did one, and it's amazing. I mean, there are thousands of this mold. They fill in with a band, una manguera, and really everything is totally full of suspension of all the plant. And they are removing. I mean, there are all the time is suspension and suspension for several tubes and collectors and. But it is quite interesting to visit them. and of course after that they sinter. One example here I put, for example, this method is used for the conventional, say, pottery or ceramics, but also, for example, these Jadro figures. I don't say if are nice or not, depend the people, but at least are really, really expensive, and they are done by this method. Okay, this is the most standard method. Regarding the furnaces, okay, well, there are many, and I don't want to focus. The oldest one was done in Iraq. Well, there are different possibilities to do it, but of course, if we want to go to a really high temperatures, probably more than 1300 degrees, we need advanced furnaces, okay? And for that is the idea of this hot isostatic preset or fill assistance. But go in detail, because if not, I can talking and talking all the time. That's not the idea. Well, it's about this process that I told you, this electrophoretic deposition that is based on the motion of charged particles in a suspension under the influence of electric field. Then here that we will have is two electrodes, and we'll put our suspension here with all particles that normally are charged. When we apply a voltage, the particles will move. If your particles are charged positive, obviously go to the negative. And that finally you obtain will be a coating here. Okay? Obviously depends several factors as usual. But well, it's important to remark that well, the, obviously the particle concentration is determinant, but obviously the electric field that you apply between your two electrodes. I don't want to go really in detail of that. The important is that you will coat. Even I think I have a video to that. Hopefully we can put it. Here is the mass that you are attaching to your electrodes as a function of time, because the electric field that you can generate can be constant in the intensity or in the voltage. Okay? Ideally or theoretically, of course, if you use intensity constant, your mass per area will increase, but we have a problem, that is that the concentration will be decreased with time, because obviously you are depositing and it's a reduction of the concentration, and then it follows mark this trajectory. The same thing happens with the potential static. This is the theoretical one, but at the end, like your concentration decreases with time, that we obtain is more like that. Advantage and disadvantage, like everything in this life. If you use a galvanostatic, as you see, looks like much better, because you can incorporate more mass per area. But the problem, if you increase the voltage, that you will start to produce is the water hydrolysis in your electrodes, and then appears bubbles, of course, then the coating is not the best one. On the other hand, you can avoid this effect using this potentiostatic, but then your yield is clearly reduced. Here, the advantage I want to summarize of the EpiDev using water media. Of course, it's no contaminant, we use water, everything is fine. Finally, we can say, wow, it's environmentally friendly process. Okay, it's good. It's also low cost and it's easy, as I show you. Okay. You put two electrodes and that's all. Yeah. You need like that your suspension is really stabilized, but well, this is quite easy by electrostatics or electrostatic material. This is quite easy. And also you can use different additives and also every kind of material. Disadvantage, what? Restriction to 13 voltage, as I told you. Also the electrolysis of water, this is so critical. Sometimes it could be when you start to accumulate the deposition, the electric field decrease and there are some modifications. And one of the disadvantages are really well, to really understand about these kinetics. Here just one show you, because you can use AC, DC, depends the properties, also pulse, and obviously with that you can perform different coatings. Okay. And here we will see if it works. It's a bit difficult. Yeah. It's running. Here are two electrodes, the suspension, okay? It's in ethanol and water. And we are using the galvanostatic. As you see here is the suspension, and this electrode is that we want to coat it. And you will see that the concentration in the suspension start to be reduced, because we start to see already like the white color or the transparent color. Okay, well, so fast, but that we see is that all the suspension that at the beginning was dark is not here, because now practically all the suspension is attached in the electrodes. Okay. Probably have better pictures because there is not easy to see. But, well, just a few factors, but I don't want again to go really in detail. Affects several things, and you can optimize to finally obtain the coating that you want. pH, of course, concentration of the suspension is critical. Particle size, sizes, shape of the particles, everything depends, because you can orientate also and have anisotropic materials. For how long do you do it? But as you saw in the video, this is a really fast process. It's so easy, depend on your substrate, depend on different things, but in general a quite easy process. And well, obviously, after a problem about the thickened coatings, I mean, you cannot produce as you want the thicker, and also the drying condition after that to avoid the cracking. That is always the problem when you work with suspension. If the concentration is low of your suspension, or the water content is so high, it is the same. At the end, you will have micro cracking. Well, the important thing is that EPD is this great versatility. Can use it in practically all the types of particles, materials, ceramics, polymer, metals, biomolecules, practically everything. The particle side also, if you can use nanometers or even millimeters particles. So it's so easy within the scaling up of this process. There are a few examples in the industry that using that. You control the deposition thickness with the time, and it's quite easy. And well, in general, I put this graph only to show you how is the interest. Maybe in the 90s, the electrophoretic deposition was not so interesting, but now, well, this graph that grows exponentially, well, it's going well, but you never know, of course, if at the end several processes will be coated with that one, or is better like atmospherics, plasma spray, or other techniques that I will show you tomorrow for the TVCs. But well, this one is an alternative that. And this is really green, and this is the idea of today. Here one example that they use to coat carbon-carbon composite. We were discussing about the burning of carbons in the previous pouch. Always that you use, for example, carbon-carbon or carbon fibers or carbon nanotubes or graphene, you need to protect against oxidation, and then you need a coating, and this is a good option to coat your materials by EPD. Well, just example that here is the carbon-carbon, it could be a silicon carbide, and here the material that was interesting to crack. Well, if you are more interested in that, pues here is the literature, but it's just to show you that the possibility in that range to oxidation protection. And again, this method, to be honest, I think it's more for a lab scale, for a really process like a turbine or some kind of element like that. There are other techniques that are more developed than EPD, but okay, anyway, it's also possible to do classical coating of a superalloy by EPD with this one. I will show you later. This one is that it's called bond coat, and like the thermal expansion of the superalloy is high, and the coating that will be here is low. You need always something between, that is the bonding. And normally it's this nickel, common chrome and alloy that is used. Again, whatever you need here, you don't have access, just ask me and I give you the paper. Also, they are quite flexible if you want to use in the solid oxide for cells. I don't know, probably you have some lectures about these materials, but well, you need several layers, glass ceramic sealants, the electrolytes, of course, or another thing, the carbon collector, of course, I mean, the complete system, and you need to avoid the direct contact between most of them. And to do that, for example, in this research, you use this spinel that coat with PPD. Here there are a couple of images, but well, the resolution is not the best one. Here a micrograph that you see that, well, it's really homogeneous and fine, and well, as I told you, it's quite easy, and it's like the video that I showed to you. Here are the results. They cover the deposition of that one and the carbon blank. It was done in the Institute of Ceramic and Glass, this research, but I just want to mention that this is also quite important, because that you can do is oriented the particles. Okay, depending the size or the shape of your particles, it's possible to orient it. For example, that one is quite interesting when you work with graphenes, for example, or this kind of thing, that you want that they are preferentially in one position, or for example, for thermal conductivity in one direction, but not in the other, then you need to orientate, and EPD is a really good one to do it. And here, well, so you is a really high orientate, all the layers are like that between the substrate and your coating. Deep coating. Well, this is other technique also to create thin layers that are quite easy, and I think it's well extended in the industry, because it's really easy. That you have is your substrate, and it's, the idea is quite simple. You introduce in the suspension, of course, when you remove it, it's there. I mean, it's like if you enter in the swimming pool and you are out, of course you are wet, it's obvious. But this one is absolutely the same. After that, they drain and evaporate the solvent, and that's all. The only thing is that you need to repeat this one a couple of times. But it's quite good if you are working in that range, that for thin films is more or less for a nanometer scale to micro scale. Here is one example of our institute. Well, this guy is working like that because it's a clean room. It's for solid oxide fuel cells, and of course there cannot be any impurities, but of course it's not required. Well, for this case, yes, but not for the deep coating itself. Just the substrate, introduced in the suspension, and go up. Just go up and go down, and it's using several companies, of course, because it's really simple, and the equipment that you require is practically nothing. And this one, go up and go down. And it's quite important because it's sustainable, or you can use in planar, in tubular, in practically all the shapes that you can imagine. And I think you've seen in that one, for example, in the glasses that I use, that glasses, but also for the sunglasses, the coating to avoid the scratch and this kind of thing are always done by deep coating, okay? Because just introduce here, coating, remove, and that's all. That is enough. You can control with the time and the velocity, the thickness, and that's all. You can do all this number of lenses in one step. Okay. There are other possibilities, but this is based more or less in the same principle or idea, that is the horizontal deep coating, that one, instead to go up and down, it moves like that, and then when it touch, it starts to be there. But well, the idea is, let's say, is the same. Yeah. And here, well, other example about the possibility to coating by deep coating of different substrates, always using electronic compounds. Do you want to insulate materials that are electronic or non-electronic? And always the homogeneity, that is the good part of the advantage of this technique, is that it's really homogeneous. A spin coating, I don't know if you have heard about that, but also it's quite easy, that you have your suspension, put a few drops, and the substrates they stay to rotate, and of course part of your material is gone, but the end that you have is a really thin layer. When you dry, of course it's a shrinkage, and that you can do with that is coating and coating more and more layers. Okay, for example, this one for solid oxide for cells, it's quite interesting. Here, just one. So you put your drop that you remove, depend of the velocity, you apply more or less, you can control the thickness, and after the evaporation. And here is one of the equipment. I never use it, but we have one. This facility, just this is the substrate. You put it, and this one rotate. As you see, well, the size of the specimen are quite hard, quite high, and I think it's a really good technique to coatings, and that is important to save a lot of material, because all the material that is gone, you can recuperate. And it's the idea of this first introduction use processing, that you save energy or material that you use in simple processes. With that one, with this speed coating, for example, is that publication that you can perform several layers with the size that you prefer. I mean, as your imagination allows you to do it. You are doing spinning and spinning of different process or different materials, sorry, and you will obtain that. Well, here is the representation, but also here you can see the cross-section, the microstructure of different materials. Well, this one is a little bit more modern, so that now is the additive manufacturing is quite interested. And this one is like a printer. Even that we have done in our institute is use a commercial printer from HP. We remove the ink and we put on ceramic ink. And it works. I mean, it's as simple as that. I mean, this one, of course, it's like the printing, then that you can have is printing method in two-dimensional. Only your container, you should create a suspension with different characteristics, but in the terms of millimeters, you use, if you want a commercial printhead, it's really cheap, and process it, okay? And here is how it works. You have your suspension and, well, modification of the voltage, it's go out. And well, here is the commercial, but as I told you, you can use even with your printer of your house, you remove it, the ink, and use your direct ink, and it works at different conditions and frequencies and so on. That is what not really interested, but here you see, well, I don't know if you really see, but it's this ink that is going there. But it's like a printer, I mean, it's nothing really special. And with that, well, this one is in German, easy to understand, it's principle of the membranes. You have your support, in that case for alpha alumina, and that we control here is the porosity, here with mesoporosity, microporosity, and macroporosity, doing different layers with this printing. Just change the suspension, like if you have the blue, red, and yellow, but here we have mesoporosity, or porosity, we change, and that finally we obtain is these nine microstructures. Well, Dr. Blake process, also to produce really large thin films. Again, so easy, you have your powder, solvent, and dispersion agent, you mix all of them, classical suspension, and that here that we do is we put out paste, and with a Dr. Blake, it's really like a blade, and then you can control moving this distance the thickness of your material. The substrate in this case is moving, like casting, and then you will coat it. The advantage of this one is that, of course, you can produce, let's say, kilometers, maybe it's exaggerated, but all that you want, I will show you facilities, and there are quite big. Here in that case, for example, between 12 and 20 meters that this one is moving, and then you obtain this one continuously. First, oh, it's this dry cabinet to remove, of course, the water, and then you have the dry film, and you cut it. And here is, for example, the facility that we have that is between the lab scale and the industrial, because, well, Fortune 100 Julius works filling this gap. It's, we don't want to process a piece like that, really ridiculous. We want to produce large facilities, but of course, trying to save energy, not like the materials. And here is this Dr. Blade that is really large. As you see here, there's a few meters up here, 12 meters. You can think a lot, yeah? But also some examples about Dr. Blades in industry because, well, as I told you, this technique are really used. I mean, it's not only for lab scales. The idea is to really an extrusion. Well, probably this one is one of the most used. If you want to do shape like you or something like that, obviously, always by extrusion. Here, more or less again, you have your suspension that, well, it should have different conditions, but mainly that you will do is press with a screw your material, and finally you will put out your material here, okay? Well, normally I put here a couple of examples of the wall thickness, because normally it's done for tube up to 3 millimeters, but I think it's better, yeah. I show you one image like that. This is a ceramic tube in a green state, of course. It requires to be sintered, but put your powder here, and by the mechanical pressure, you extrude this material. Advantage is that you can use, of course, all the materials that you want, metallic powder, ceramic powders, everything. Only that you need is to prepare a suspension with determined characteristics, okay? Then that you put here, it's the mouthpiece that is called. You can use that one, for example, to produce this one, for example, for the solar that I show you with the silicon carbide, or different, like, for example, this one for tubes. Always that probably you see a ceramic tube is done by extrusion. Here, there's other technique. Again, for thin layers is the screen printing. Well, this is a half automatic, but practically don't do to do anything. Here is like a combination. You have here your mask, and you produce again like a suspension. And with this squeezer or doctor blade, you move and fill the gap of the mask. Okay, this one is moving, as you see here, and then we will fill this part, okay? Again, it's really cheap. You can use practically all the materials. The problem is that it's only available, let's say, for planar substrates. You cannot do complex structure, but if you want to do it, are well used in the industry, for example, for the cars, in the glass, always they are doing by this technique. But to show you really how it works, it's like printing of a t-shirt that you have is a mask, you put your suspension, and at the end is there. Just use the classical things that we see in our life, but are also high technology. The principle is the same. Here, maybe with that, it's easy to understand how it works. Okay, the mask, you put the squeeze, your suspension, routine, and you already have it. Okay. More techniques, so roll casting, well, the classical roll casting. Here you have a suspension and it's dropping. You control your velocity in this roll, and at the end that you obtain, it's a thin layer, okay? Other alternative, instead the dropping that sometimes is complex, you have two rods, you put your suspension there, and it's going. Or the inverse roll coating, that is a little bit more complex, but in general it's based in the same principle. You put your suspension here, it rotates, and finally you got your suspension. Okay, there are different methods in order to finally the thickness or different materials. And here a couple of examples of this double milling, different equipment. A lab scale, but you can produce really large material with that. For example, here I want to show you this using roll coating for the solid oxide fuel cells. I think you asked me about the thickness. Well, this one is different. It's not lithium compounds, but just to have your idea. This is the carbon collectors, normally are porous structure, and here you have a really thick, thin layer. Yeah, it's where all the people is working. I mean, at the end, the material that you produce is really low. Here, in that case, was from an anode substrate, but can be for the electrolyte or whatever you want. Okay? But normally, we are working in that range. The vacuum sleep. Well, this one is also easy. Here that you have is a porous substrate. You put your suspension, and obviously when you apply a vacuum, it's drained your material, and at the end that you have is a film that is here that we produce. As you see, always the material you have to produce a homogeneous and stable suspension, but you put here, apply the vacuum, and you have the thickness of the layer. Okay, it's really easy, and you have again between 5 and 20 microns with these techniques, because well, for the application that we are looking for, this is the parameter, but probably you want more, it's just a question of time. Okay. Well, different advantage or characteristics, because well, this is quite good for the size. You obtain a really high package that is quite good, and well, the problem is the time consuming, that as your layer is thicker and thicker, of course the time is reduced. But in general, it's an interesting technique. Other possibility, this wet powder spraying. It's like a spray. You have a suspension again, and you spray your material. Characteristic, of course, here you can coat practically everything and with all kinds of materials. You can coat dents or porous substrates, for example, for solid oxides, for the collectors. Planar, tubular, or really complex. Well, in general, as you see, you can code practically whatever you want, only taking care of the times that you pass through, but you will obtain a really homogeneous layer. Well, more about this spraying that I showed to you. Here is the gun. Here there are the solid oxide fuel cells, and what you see is coating this layer with this technique, as you see. We move the substrate. The only thing is that you need to control different parameters like the distance, the pressure, but once that is optimized, you have several possibilities. And here, as you see, for example, if you want to go, just need to rotate and can be done in complex structure like, well, I don't know, really like plates for tubing plates or different structures.
Oh, un minutito.
Sí, claro. Okay, well, the only problem with these techniques is, of course, if you go planar structure on a tube, it's quite good. The only problem is when you have this kind of structure or possibility of cut. Always here you have this problem of maybe some cracks, but well, it happens practically to all the techniques. When you have this kind of structure, it's quite complex that when you try in or sinter, this crack doesn't appear. Okay? But well, this one, just to tell you, it was a coating for the solid oxide fuel cell in the connectors, because obviously you need to insulate. And now about the sintering techniques, we are close to finish. Well, if you want to densify advanced materials, I mentioned silicon carbide, or silicon nitride, or ultra high temperature ceramics, materials that require really high temperature, you need advanced techniques. It's not just in a furnace, and normally that you need is that the densification is assisted by pressure. Okay, this was isostatic pressure. Well, I will show you, but it's just one example to see it. This one, even I don't know if it's old equipment, but what is this size and this SPS that we have in our laboratory. Okay? But first, the hot isostatic pressing. Probably you have heard about that, but it's probably the most used sintering technique for ceramics, for well, for different reasons, but also for metal components. That here, well, you have a different advantage. But well, first, I think I should show you how it works. That you have two possibilities, is or start from, let's say, from zero, from a green body, and densify, but then you will need to encapsulate, or if your material has only a closed porosity, you can use directly the hot isostatic pressing, because that here that you use is heating with a resistant, like classical furnace, but you will have the densification introducing a lot of high pressure. Then that you use is the combination of heat and gap pressure to sinter. The advantage, well, of course you can sinter whatever you want, it's great, but it's important that there are no lubricants or sinters, because then with the gas, with the pressure, it's a problem. Well, that here, that was important. Well, in terms of stresses, in general, I mean, it's good for practically all the materials, and of course for the homogeneous density distribution, this is critical. However, the problem, well, I don't know if it's here, yeah, the costly is really expensive, and also in terms of safety, unfortunately, in our equipment 20 years ago, we had a problem, explode when it was introducing the gas, and the technician died. And they moved from our institute, and it's one building only to use it, because several companies contacted us to see their really pieces, like really large pieces for aeronautic industry and different things, but I mean, it's quite dangerous. Yeah. Well, if you do the things bad or something happen, okay? Then, as I told you, there are different possibilities, but normally you need to introduce in a capsule, you put your materials, close it, and then sinter, because that you need that the gas is acting over your capsule. If you don't introduce a capsule, this gas will avoid that you close your porosity, because also the gas will hinder the densification, will produce that the porous is never gone. Yeah? Well, as I told you, you fill your capsule, evacuate all the gas and sealing, and then you do the heap. This is the typical capsule with different geometries, but I think, well, yeah, here there are some that are more for commercial applications, and also you can use glass capsules, okay? The capsule materials will have, obviously, different properties. Normally, the classical one is this one, stainless steel, but there are possibilities for others. If you go to the part of ceramics, possible reaction with the stainless steel, and then it's better to use these glass capsules. And yeah, this one is that I want to show you. Here is the capsules when we are not talking about only material of a couple of millimeters. You need to produce here your piece, and this is the size of the, if you want to perform really large materials. That you can perform materials like that, really complex, okay? This is not like maybe the first presentation that I show you that are like possible techniques, or like the spark plasma sintering that I will show you later. With these techniques, several pieces are done, and also because in one step you can produce several of them, okay? And here is one example about how the pore is eliminated. Here there are two blocks with obviously a really big holes that we like one port. We close it. This one is for the evacuation of the air, because of course we need that here is not gas, because if it doesn't work, and at the end we do the heap, and when you analyze the cross section, this one is totally gone, and it has material inside for the effect of the pressure. Well, there are different possibilities to use the atmospheres to use in the heap. Typically, the people use argon, yeah, here 90% of the application, normally with a graphite heater, it's like in the SPS, because you can achieve really high temperatures, but if you want to go to lower temperatures, normally for metals it's not required, obviously go to this temperature, then it's the classical molybdenum heating elements. Other option is to use nitrogen as gas, or this one is when you want to go to maybe higher temperatures, silicon nitride, or even with that you combine with the graphite, or that is quite interesting, but I think there are not many facilities in the world, is using oxygen also as the external, but of course it's just for materials that like zirconia or alumina that cannot be oxidized but are already oxidized. And this one is quite interesting for this kind of ceramics materials. Here one example of our equipment was only the screws to avoid that the pressure, because the pressure in the chamber is quite high. Well, this is other technician, but this is the chamber, how it goes and go down. Our facility is 7 liters, but it's possible obviously higher, and here is the pressure. Of course, work with 3,000 bars of pressure what I mean, you need it for this equipment, but it's quite hard. I just mentioned that I told you here with this facility we can use argon or nitrogen or even nitrogen oxygen. It's called technical air. It's quite interesting, and for that many companies contact with us. Here, just to show you how is really the heating elements. This one is made of graphite. Of this one is the super cantal that is called with different salt for heating. And here, yeah, the facility. As I told you, here one person to compare the size, this diameter and this height. Okay, and a couple of examples of pieces that they require for us and we center, and it's for example this kind of components for this company, a Swedish company. Okay. And of course you have the possibility to perform more in the lab scales. Also research, I just want to show you it's possible to really close the porosity of many ceramics material if you are below 100 nanometers or something like that. You obtain transparent ceramics, but you need that is 100% dense. Okay, then we do a pressureless sintering on this material, and you see it's not transparent because, well, has some defects and so on. But if you do heat, this one is a ceramic, okay, and it's totally transparent. Of course, it has a lot of advantages. You have a ceramic instead of glass in terms of ceramic. Okay, but well, anyway, this one is in a lab scale, as you say, it's not so big, and well, maybe in the future the companies are more interested. And well, the SPS, I showed you in the other slide, even in the other presentation I used the same slide. I don't know if for you was clear in the previous one, but now is the moment to ask me if you don't understand something. Here that you put is your powder here, and it's, everything is surrounded by graphite, and then you can heat, okay? I don't want to go in detail, just a couple of slides. Finish, this is the facility, the electrodes, and what here, the molds that we fill. Okay, and this one, the graphite mold, the graphite foil that you see, you cut it to introduce it and so on, but well, this is the facility, how it works. Different materials and modeling depend. I think we talk about the gradient of temperature. Here is some representation about that, about this difference in temperature if you have large or smaller size. A material that can be densified, you see that one. This one, for example, is silicon nitride containing carbon nanotubes. Or this one are mag faces that are a layer materials. So this one is thin oxide. And this one, for example, is a composite material of zirconium diboride and silicon carbide particles. All of them were sintered in our labs with SPS because the versatility is quite high, and always the density is quite high using the SPS. And yeah, I think that this is everything. Only I would like to mention knowledge to Sandra Cabaña to give me these slides about the EPD and explain me everything that I know. She did a PhD in the Instituto Ceramica class, where I also did, but now she's working in a Netherlands company, Johnson Matthey. And of course, Martin Brand, a really expert in HIP technology, or another technology, but especially in HIP, and he gave me practically all the slides for this presentation. And you, of course, to stay here until almost 2 o'clock. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Any question?
Hi, thank you for. Hi? Okay. Thank you for the presentation. And I have a question about the mold that you use in HIP profession. Mm-hmm. That is, when you said that to ceramics is better to use glass molds. Mm-hmm. How can these molds made of such a brittle material?
I don't know if you see here, this part is like the conventional glass that is formed. It's like a bubble. Mm-hmm. They put the powder and they heat. And they start to throw away the like a tube we need to introduce there, and at the end they do vacuum and close it, just cooling. It's a glass that is like viscous, and then you heat a determined temperature, and then by cooling it's just closed.
Okay, thank you.
No. More questions or comments or I don't know, whatever. Then I think that you are free. Tomorrow morning 9:30 we start again. Thank you.
Gracias a todos. Nos vemos mañana. Thank you very much, everybody. Gracias.